Shalom Hadabardix. Shalom. Welcome to our next session, our next class from Hadavar Messianic Ministries and our School of Biblical and Jewish Studies. This class is entitled The Jewish Life of the Messiah. This is going to be the 2021 edition. I presented this class earlier, 5 years or so ago, and so our technology has improved, so I'm going to redo it with improved technology. So we're in Lesson 1, Session 1. Now, before we go any further, let me introduce any of you that are not familiar with Hadavar Ministries, Hadavar Messianic Ministries, to the ministry and to myself. The best way to do that is to go to our website, and the homepage will look something like this. This is not the exact homepage the way it looks today, because this is a older version of the homepage. But just go there, and it'll look something like this, and it's at www.hadavar.org. So come to our homepage. One thing that will be the same is the menu across the top of the page. So go up to the menu and focus your attention on the School of Biblical and Jewish Studies area. Click on that, and a drop-down menu will occur. Then I want you to drop down to Instructors. This will take you to the Instructor page. Now, the Instructor page will look something like this. All you'll have to do is to scroll down the page until you see my name and photograph. And it may not be number 2 on the list, it may be quite a bit ways down on the current instructor page, but just go ahead and scroll down the page. Well, click in that area and it'll take you to my information page. This will tell you about me, a little more personal information, so you get to know me a little bit better. All right, back to our main page. This time, scroll down to the classes, to the class section. And this will take you to the current classes and or the online class archive. I believe the online class archive is all that we are showing now on this page. Now, at this page, you'll have an opportunity to donate to Hadavar Messianic Ministries. Now, that is totally optional. Totally optional. These classes are available to anyone who likes to take them in, regardless of finances. But if you would like to donate to help us continue with these classes, that would always be very, very helpful for us. So that's an option there. You can click on the donate button. And if you do, thank you very much. We deeply appreciate it. All right, what I'd like you to do when you get to the online class archive is to scroll down the online class archive. Just keep on coming down until you get to the Jewish Life of Messiah 2021 edition. Make sure you're going to the 2021 edition. It's a higher quality edition than the previous presentation of this class. Click in that area. That'll take you to the class page. Now, on the class page, you can scroll down the class page and read a synopsis of the class, get some information of where we're going. As you get to the bottom of the class page, you'll come to the outline. You'll come to the PDF material that is yours to download if you would like to follow through. Now, I would advise that you do follow through on this outline. I think it'll make the class a lot clearer if you do. Now, in regard to this outline, it's not a formal outline. It's a bit informal. What I have done is to insert my comments under basic headings so that you won't be distracted by note-taking. Now, if you like note-taking, you should have plenty of room to do so. I've tried to leave plenty of room on each page for those of you who like to write, and I know a number of people like to take notes. Primarily, I'm a little different. I like to listen and concentrate on what the teacher is saying. So that's what I want you to do. I want you to listen and concentrate what I have to say without distraction, knowing that the major points are contained on the outline. So you're not going to miss anything. Now, I've not inserted every word and every comment that I will make on the outline. I've attempted to insert only the most important concepts that I want you to take away from the study, and charts as well. So the online outline is not exhaustive, but it will help you follow through the class. And there are the handouts that additional handouts that I have given to previous classes are available as well. So I will try to keep you abreast of where I am in the outline and in the harmony. All right. Now, the book I will be using, the textbook we'll be using for this class, is A Harmony of the Gospels by Thomas and Gundry. Now, there are three versions of this Harmony of the Gospels available. I'll be reading from the New American Standard Version, but the New International Version is available, and it's also available in the King James Version. Now, I'd recommend very highly that you get this book. You don't have to have it, but it'll make this class a lot easier to follow if you have it, because this is the textbook we'll be going through. And I think it'll be a valuable book to your library from this class on anyway. Now, Thomas and Gundry chose to divide up the life of the Messiah into sections that you will see on the Hadavar outline. So let's take a look at the Harmony. Let's take a look at this book and page 7 of the Harmony. This is page 7. Now, let's go in for a closer look at this first page. Here's a close look. Now, the section numbers beginning on page 7 of the Harmony correspond to the numbers on the Hadavar outline. So you can see the section number there, and then a very brief description of that section. Then as you move across the page to the right, you will see a column marked Matthew. And the sections of Matthew that are covered in the Harmony appear there. And you can see that Matthew only covers the early life of the Messiah very briefly. Going to the right, we now come to the column marked Mark, and we see that Mark did not cover anything regarding the early life of the Messiah. He chose to ignore that aspect of Yeshua's life. Going to the right, one more column, we come to Luke, and you see that Luke covered the early years of Jesus in great detail. And then as we go once more to the right, we come to John, and John actually covered the pre-incarnate existence of Messiah. And then on the far right, this is the page number in the Harmony where that section will be found. Now, when a Harmony puts the parallel sections in parallel columns, so if only one gospel covers an event, it'll show up in one column. And so here you see section 200, the lament over Jerusalem, is only covered by Matthew, and so it's in its own column. It's in a single column. But if we drop down to section 201, which is the poor widow's gift, then we see that was covered by Matthew and Luke. And so that appears in two columns. And if an incident is covered by all three of the Gospels, it's shown in three columns side by side, and a few of the incidents are covered by all four Gospels. This is the feeding of the 5,000, and so you see all four accounts are set up side by side so you can compare them. This is what a Harmony is all about. Okay, so I'll refer to section numbers for you, those of you with the Harmony, and I'll refer to scripture verses for those of you without the book. So let's move on to methodology. There's two aspects to the methodology that I'm going to be using. The first aspect is geographical area. Now there are several harmonies available with the life of Messiah divided up in different ways. Some harmonies use geographical divisions. That's the most traditional way most harmonies are set up. And if you look at the chart on page 6 of your outline, you'll see that. And so these harmonies use titles such as the early, middle, and late Galilean ministry, the early, middle, and late Judean ministry, the early, middle, and late Perean ministry, something like that. Now, there's nothing wrong with a geographical approach to outlining the life of the Messiah. But geographical divisions are not the only way to divide up the life of the Messiah. And there is a drawback to the geographical approach. This kind of approach can cause you to miss relationships between incidents. So as a result, I won't be covering the life of the Messiah under a purely geographical sense. I'll follow an integration of two approaches. So I'll always be using a thematic approach as well. I'll use both a geographic and a thematic approach. What I mean is that I'll introduce and note important themes we encounter as we move through the study. The advantage of the thematic factor is that we'll see the relationship of one section to another and of one event to another, even if they are geographically separated. This way we'll get a better look at the life of Messiah. We'll see that all incidents mentioned have a reason for being there, and we'll see the relationship of one to another. For example, we'll come across a very, very important events that happen in Galilee, and they are later picked up in Jerusalem to the south and later. Now, another aspect of this class is Jewish backgrounds. I'll be going deep into first century Jewish backgrounds. See, the advantage of a thematic factor is that we deal with the issues as the issues were faced at the time that Jesus was dealing with them. The Judaism that Jesus faced was the Judaism of the Pharisees. So many statements that are often misunderstood. Many statements are often misunderstood, not because the words are unclear, but because people don't understand the Jewish thinking behind the statement. Too many commentators have a tendency to go back to Roman and Greek tradition and Roman and Greek culture when dealing with a statement. By and large, the events of the gospel take place in the context of Jewish culture, Jewish tradition. And so many of the issues faced were prominent issues in the culture of Jewish days. For example, Jesus' claim to kingship and its subsequent rejection will be heavily related to Pharisaic Judaism. Also, many statements that Gentile believers argue about become quite clear when viewed from a Jewish context. An expression like born again can only be fully understood when it's put into the Jewish thinking and culture of the day. See, what you have to do is you have to interpret, interpret the text in the manner that it was understood by the audience to whom it was given. God gave this text, this revelation, to a particular audience, and he wanted them to understand what was written. So we need to understand it in the manner in which they understood it. We can then apply it to our lives in the 21st century and in the West, but we have to understand it the way the original receptors understood the statement. All right, reading requirements. You may want to read ahead of the class and the lecture. If you come to a section of parallel accounts where Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all talk about the same incident, please read all accounts, 1, 2, 3, and 4. If you have a harmony, please read all the passages noted on your outline. The way each writer covers his version of the event is based on the theme of his gospel. I'm sorry, I made a misstatement there previously. If you do not have a harmony, please read all the passages noted on the outline. If you have a harmony, it's easy. They're right there before you. But if you do not, it's in your outline. So please read all the passages noted. Now, the way each writer covers his version of the event is based on the theme of his gospel. We'll treat the event with his theme predominantly in view. We'll be relating the differences in emphasis each writer makes when recording the event. So please be sure to read all parallel accounts that you encounter and try to note the differences in emphasis that each writer makes. Now, I will not be reading every verse of every section, so read ahead and be familiar with each section. All right, with that in mind, let's take a look at the basic divisions of the harmony. Thomas and Gundry divided up the life of Messiah into 13 major divisions in their book. And the basic divisions of the harmony are laid out on page 5 of your outline. They are as follows. Number 1, a preview of who Jesus is. Number 2, the early years of John the Baptist. 3, the early years of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. 4th, the public ministry of John the Baptist, John the Immerser. 5, the end of John's ministry and the beginning of Messiah's, largely in Judea. 6, the ministry of Messiah in Galilee. 7, the ministry of Messiah around Galilee. 8, the later Judean ministry of Messiah. Can you see the geographical approach that's so prominent in Thomas and Gundry's harmony? And that's not wrong, but it is prominent, and it does have its drawbacks. 9, the ministry of Messiah in and around Perea. 10, the formal presentation of Messiah to Israel and the resulting conflict. 11, prophecies in preparation for the death of Messiah. 12, the death of Messiah. And 13, the resurrection and ascension of the Messiah. So those are the basic divisions you'll see in the harmony. Now, before we go any further, I'd like to discuss with you the most important way, the best way, probably, well, I think it's really the by far the superior way to study the Bible. And you study the Bible by following the golden rule of interpretation. I believe this is a very wise and very complete and very useful rule to memorize. So here it is. It was created by, let's get my arm out of the way there. Let's see, this arm. It was created by Dr. D.L. Cooper. Dr. Cooper. When the plain sense of Scripture makes common sense, seek no other sense. Therefore, take every word in its primary, ordinary, usual, literal meaning, unless the facts of the immediate context studied in the light of related passages and axiomatic and fundamental truths indicates otherwise. That's a mouthful, isn't it? You think, what? I'm supposed to memorize that? Yeah, you will. So let's go back over this golden rule and let's tear it apart a little bit so it won't be so intimidating, because once you see what the parts mean, I think it'll make a lot of sense to you. So let's go back over the rule. Here is the basic rule itself. When the plain sense of Scripture makes common sense, seek no other sense. Therefore, take every word at its primary, ordinary, usual, literal meaning. In other words, read the words the way you'd read a newspaper. All right? Their primary, ordinary, usual, literal meaning. In other words, the text of the Bible is to be taken exactly as is read, unless there's something significant in the context indicating that the statement should be taken in some other way than literal. That is, as a symbol or figure of speech. All right, so we should take everything in its primary, ordinary, usual, literal sense, unless there's a very good reason not to. Unless there's a very good reason not to. Well, that's why we have the word unless in the golden rule of interpretation. The word unless tips us off that the plain meaning is not always the intended meaning. We have to keep that in mind. For example, John 10:7-9, Jesus says, I am the door. Is Jesus a slab of wood with hinges on his hips and hinges on his shoulder, and he goes back and forth and lets people in and out? Of course not. Jesus is talking symbolically there. He's comparing himself to a door that lets people in and out. How about Luke 13:32? Just at that time, some Pharisees approached, saying to him, go away, leave here, for Herod wants to kill you. And he said to them, go tell that fox. Was Jesus telling us literally that Herod was a little dog-like creature? Of course not. Herod was a man like you and me, but he was sly and clever and smart, the way a fox is sly and clever and smart. So he was comparing Herod's character to the character of a fox. So the plain meaning of the text is not always the intended meaning. That's why the word unless is there. So how do you determine how do you determine when you should go to a symbolic or figurative understanding of the text? You know, we have to recognize symbols and figures of speech, right? But how do you do it? Well, here's some help for you. First of all, take everything in its primary, ordinary, usual, literal meaning, unless the facts of the immediate context. There's your first key word, context. Context is king. The Bible only teaches one thing if you keep it in context. You know, people say you can teach anything you want from the Bible. They're right if you take it out of context. One example here. Psalm 10:4 says, there is no God. Does that mean the Bible teaches atheism? Well, you know, 14 times in the Bible you'll find this statement, there is no God. You'll also find it in Psalm 14:1, there is no God. You'll find it in Psalm 53:1, there is no God. You know, 11 more times you'll find it if you look in your concordance. Does the Bible teach atheism? Well, let's see. Let's put these sentences back into context. Here's Psalm 10:4, our first one. Let's put it back into context. The wicked, in the haughtiness of his countenance, does not seek him. All his thoughts are, there is no God. Ah, so the scripture is really talking about the wicked. And I'm sorry for all you atheists. God says, when all your thoughts are on, there is no God, he considers you wicked. and Psalm 14:1. Is it teaching atheism? The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Whoever is an atheist, and from God's perspective, is a fool. And the same thing with Psalm 53:1. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. So the Bible does not teach atheism. In fact, just the opposite. And so while you can teach anything you want, if you pull something out of context, the Bible only teaches one thing when it's put back into context. All right, so there's our first keyword, context. Take everything in its primary, ordinary, usual, literal meaning, unless the immediate context, studied in the light of related passages. All right, these are your cross references. These are other references in the Bible that impact the one you're studying. In fact, this expands the range of context a bit. You know, a word fits within a phrase fits within a sentence in a paragraph in a chapter in a biblical book within the Bible, and the Bible within a culture. So related passages can expand your context quite a bit, and that's why we look heavily into Jewish culture to expand our context to include way Jewish people thought and spoke in the first century. All right, so take everything in its ordinary, usual, literal meaning, unless the context studied in light of related passages and axiomatic and fundamental truths indicates otherwise. Okay, two important words, axiom or axiomatic. What is an axiom? What is something that is axiomatic? Well, an axiom is a self-evident or universally recognized truth. A self-evident or universally recognized truth. For example, if I make the statement to you, gravity exists, I don't have to prove that statement. It's self-evident. It's universally recognized. Why? Because every single one of you are sitting on the ground there. You're sitting on a chair. Your feet are on the ground. If you drop something, what does it do? It goes down, right? Gravity exists. That's self-evident and universally recognized. It's an axiom. We can't violate axioms. A fundamental truth. What is a fundamental truth? Well, a fundamental is an essential or necessary part. For example, God is one. There's only one God. God is love. We can't violate the character and attributes of God. So fundamentals are much broader than that, of course. So this is the golden rule of interpretation. Let's look at it one more time, I hope with better understanding. And yes, try to memorize this. Every time you go to your Bible study, repeat it and try to follow it as you go through your Bible study. So, when the plain sense of Scripture makes common sense, seek no other sense. Therefore, take every word at its primary, ordinary, usual, literal meaning, unless there's a very, very, very good reason you should not. Unless the facts of the immediate context, and here's how you do that. Unless the facts of the immediate context, studied in light of related passages, context, cross-references, and axiomatic and fundamental truths, indicates otherwise. Get those four items in line, and that would indicate that you must take this phrase, statement, concept, some way other than literal. All righty. Well, that's my background material for you. Let's move into lesson one, which is page two, lesson one, page two in your outline. Section one is Luke's purpose for writing the gospel in Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. This is on page 19 of the Harmony. So please refer to your outline. As you can see on your outline, the first section is introductory. It's a preview. Section 1 deals with the reason why Luke wrote his gospel account. I'll use section 1 to deal with a general overview of each gospel. Let's begin with the problem that each gospel writer faced. So we're looking at the problem, and the problem is choosing the material. As the four gospel writers approached the life of Yeshua, they couldn't possibly tell us everything that Jesus said and did. John says this much in John 21, verses 24 and 25. This is the disciple who is testifying to these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true. And there are also many other things which Jesus did, which if they were written in detail, I suppose that even the world itself would not contain the books that would be written. So as the four gospel writers approached the life of Jesus, they couldn't possibly tell us everything. So John realizes that he couldn't possibly record for us everything that Jesus said and did. He can't. So let's illustrate this problem. Let's illustrate this problem by pretending that the life of Yeshua is made up of 15 incidents, and only 15 incidents. Now, John says he can't record all 15. He says he recorded only a small segment of all that he was an eyewitness to. So let's make believe that the book of John recorded incidents number 3, number 9, and number 14. Matthew comes along to write his account of the life of Messiah, and he looks over everything that Jesus said and did. He realizes he can't put it all down. He prays about what he should record. Then God responds to his prayer by impressing upon his mind a theme. Based on that theme, Matthew picks out incidents from the life of Jesus that illustrate this idea. He picks out and chooses specific events, specific episodes. He chooses some and rejects others, putting only the appropriate events into his gospel account. So he chooses, we'll make believe that he chooses incidents 1, 4, 9, and 13. Mark comes along and does the same thing. However, the theme God wants him to write is different. As a result, he goes through the same procedure of picking events appropriate for his theme. So he would pick events number 1, 5, 11, and 15, for example. Luke does the same thing, choosing events 2, 9, 12, and 15. Now, some of the gospel writers' choices overlap, and that's what I've illustrated by putting incident number 9 in three of the gospels. Three of the four gospels are covering incident number 9. So sometimes the gospel writers, chose to record the same incident, but they would choose it for different reasons. As they record the incident, the way they record it will vary according to the emphasis of their individual theme. Now, please note, the gospel accounts are not contradictory. Now, many people, liberal, unbelieving scholars, Jewish anti-missionaries especially, criticize the New Testament for being unreliable and inconsistent and contradictory. However, that's not the case at all. The four gospels are like four witnesses on each corner of an intersection viewing an automobile accident. Here, let's make believe we're at the corner of Keren HaYesud and Ziv Jabotinsky, there I got it, in Jerusalem. We're at that corner, and at each part of the corner, we have a different witness, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So what happens? These cars come together and wham, there's an automobile accident. Now, each eyewitness report of the automobile accident will vary because each eyewitness views the accident from a different perspective. So, and the gospel writers had to be selective. They had too much material to choose from. They couldn't do it all. And as a result, they recorded the material that was important to them and their theme, their point of view. Now, one other aspect we have to make sure we keep cognizance of is the cultural context of the events. And I'd like to read to you excerpts from this article, What Price the Uniqueness of Yeshua, by Anthony J. Saldarini. This appeared in 1999 in Bible Review, and there's a website link to this article. Well, what did Anthony J. Saldarini say? To wrench Yeshua out of his Jewish world destroys Yeshua and destroys Christianity. Pretty important statement, right? We have to keep Yeshua tied to Jewish culture. We have to keep that automobile accident that we see there in a Jewish context. To wrench Yeshua out of his Jewish world destroys Yeshua and destroys Christianity. The religion that grew out of his teachings, even Yeshua's most familiar role as a Messiah, is a Jewish role. If Christians leave the concrete realities of Yeshua's life, that's the fact that he was an actual man, that he trod actual dirt in an actual city and in an actual country, if Christians leave the concrete realities of Yeshua's life and of the history of Israel in favor of a mythic, universal, spiritual Yeshua and an otherworldly kingdom of God, if everything here is symbolic and has no concrete meaning, what have you done? They deny their origins in Israel, their history, and the God who loved and protected Israel and the church. They cease to interpret the actual Yeshua sent by God and remake him in their own image and likeness. He's no longer the real Yeshua, their Yeshua. The dangers are obvious. If Christians violently wrench Yeshua out of his natural, ethnic, and historical place within the people of Israel, they open the way to doing equal violence to Israel, the place and people of Yeshua. This is a lesson of history that haunts us at the end of the 20th century. All right, so keep every incident and the points of view that each gospel writer has within a Jewish context. Very important. That's what we're going to be doing in this class. All right, let's compare each gospel. I want you to refer to your chart different aspects of the Messiah presented in the four gospels. This is lesson 1, page 3 in your outline. Now, I won't go through all the aspects listed on the chart on page 3. I want to highlight some important ones. They're highlighted in bold on your chart at the top. Now, before I go any further, let me explain what the word synoptic means. You will often hear that Matthew, Mark, and Luke are referred to as the synoptic gospels. Matthew, Mark, and Luke have collectively been called the synoptic gospels since the 18th century, so it's a relatively recent term. In the 18th century, scholars began studying them in books with parallel columns. The columns were called synopsis. A synopsis literally means seeing together. It's derived from Greek. So they printed the texts of Matthew, Mark, and Luke side by side so they could make close comparisons. And we're doing the very same thing when we use our harmony. So remember section 105 here, feeding of the 5,000? All four gospel accounts cover that incident, and so there's four columns comparing each gospel. Now, Mark has normally been considered the first gospel to be written. However, most recent scholarship has pretty much concluded that Matthew, not Mark, in all probability, was the first gospel. So we'll start with Matthew in the first column. We'll look at the aspects that Matthew is going to address. First of all, the theme. Matthew's theme, Jesus the Mighty King, Yeshua the Mighty King. The audience he's writing to is a Jewish audience. Now, each gospel writer wrote his account in order to meet a need. Naturally, the first need would arise among the Jewish believers. Since the early days of the church, every believer was Jewish. Now, as a result of the martyrdom of Stephen and the subsequent persecution, the Jewish believers were dispersed. They were no longer under the central authority of the apostles. So up until the stoning of Stephen, the Jewish believers stuck together under the direct authority of the apostles. And the apostles were eyewitnesses to the life of Messiah, and they could propagate vocally, verbally, orally, what Yeshua said and did. But now the apostles were dispersed, and the church needed an authoritative source to refer to as they continued to proclaim Jesus the Messiah, the King of the Jews. And to meet that need, Matthew wrote his gospel. So the need met in Matthew. The Jewish believers needed an authoritative source. Now, what were Matthew's chief concerns? A typical question a Jew would ask then, and they would ask now, is, if Yeshua really was the King Messiah, why wasn't the kingdom set up? He didn't fulfill prophecy. Why didn't he set up the kingdom? That's a typical objection even today. Now, Matthew explains in his gospel why the kingdom was not instituted even though Yeshua is King of the Jews. He explains what scripture was fulfilled at the first coming. I've summarized this factor under the statement that it might be fulfilled. Therefore, the purposes of Matthew's gospel are twofold, so that Jesus is the king and to explain why the kingdom had not been set up. And the explanation, first coming, not second coming prophecies are fulfilled. Remember, the Messianic coin has two sides. Now, the rabbis are not going to show you both sides of the Messianic coin. One side is the suffering Messiah. One side is the reigning Messiah. They will flop the coin down on its face and only show you the reigning Messiah prophecies. What you have to do is flop the coin over and reveal and the suffering Messiah prophecies and exegete them. Remember, the Messianic coin has two sides, and both sides must be considered, not just the reigning Messiah side. Now, Matthew is also writing to Jews in light of impending judgment, that judgment soon to come. Soon to come upon the nation is the destruction of the temple and Jerusalem in 70 AD. All right, let's move on and consider the Gospel of Mark. Mark's theme, Jesus the Messiah, the servant of the Lord, the obedient servant of the Lord. The audience, Mark writes to Romans. Now, how did Romans think? Would they feel, what would they feel the world needed? Well, the main interest in a Roman would be rapid action. Rome was a very militaristic society, and they liked the idea of a command given and a command carried out speedily. They liked the idea of a servant given a mission and completing the mission completely and efficiently. Therefore, Mark emphasizes that Jesus did just that. Yeshua was the ideal servant who was given a mission and who set out to accomplish that mission with a sense of urgency. And so there's a sense of urgency throughout the writings of Mark, a sense of getting it done. Over 40 different times, Mark uses terms like straightaway, like immediately, like forthwith, depending on the translation that you have. So the need met, the Romans were practical, they identified with urgent accomplishment. All right, however, let's remember that Mark was not a Roman. Mark was Jewish, and he's concerned about the Jewish community. And as a result, the Jewish flavor is still there. He portrays Jesus as a servant of the Lord, and so that satisfies the Romans' need for urgent accomplishment and obedience. And I've summarized that in the word that you would find in the NASB, the straight way. But on the other hand, let's look on the other side. But on the other hand, from his Jewish background, the concept of the servant of the Lord, he takes out of Isaiah the prophet. Isaiah developed this theme throughout his writings. The Messiah is the servant of the Lord, the servant sent by God to accomplish certain missions. So Mark takes this background from Isaiah, from the servant of the Lord, and shows how Jesus fits this concept as well. He shows that what Isaiah said about the servant of the Lord is fulfilled in Jesus of Nazareth, Yeshua HaNotri. So both Roman and Jewish needs are met in the obedient servant of Mark, the obedient servant theme. All right, let's move on to Luke. And Luke's theme is the ideal Son of Man, Jesus the Messiah, the Son of Man. Now, Luke is writing primarily to Greeks, a Greek audience. He was a diaspora Jew. Luke was a diaspora Jew, very familiar with Greek thinking. And he had a burden for Gentile salvation as well. Now, the Greeks were interested in the ideal man. So he points out the ideal humanity of Yeshua. He alone records incidents where Yeshua develops mentally, physically, spiritually, and socially. So that's the need that he was meeting. The Greeks sought the ideal man. They were also historically minded. Because of historical importance in the Greek mind, because of the need for historical accuracy, this gospel is written. And Luke chapter 1, 1 through 4 tells us why Luke chose to write the gospel. He said, Luke 1, 1 through 4, inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile an account of the things accomplished among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word, it seemed fitting for me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write it out for you in consecutive order, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the exact truth about the things you have been taught. So Luke tells us he's using certain eyewitness accounts. Matthew, Mark, and John were all eyewitnesses to the life of Jesus. Luke, however, was not an eyewitness to any of the events of the life of Jesus. Why does he feel he needs to write a gospel when gospel accounts have already been written? And the two gospel accounts that were already available were the gospels of Matthew and Mark. John will not write his gospel at this time. John will not write his gospel until around 90 AD, much later. So Luke implies that he made use of Matthew and Mark. But we also know that he used material he got from Mary, the mother of Yeshua. He knows this because he mentioned things that went on in Mary's mind that the other writers know nothing about. So he interviewed eyewitnesses in order to compile his account. Now, the reason why he was led of God to do this is in verse 3. And the word consecutive order is the important word there. It's translated, the word is translated in order in the King James Version. It's translated orderly account in the NIV. And the NASB, I think, has the best job. They translated consecutive order, because the word means the chronological order. The word translated consecutive order means chronological order. Now, Luke was the only gospel writer who attempts to put the life of Jesus in true historical chronological sequence. This is his primary contribution, and he will be our chronological roadmap. The other writers were not chronologically concerned. They were thematically oriented. They might record event A and B because the events develop their theme. They might develop event B 5 pages after they develop event A. But event B might have occurred chronologically before event A. So if we assume a chronological sequence to Matthew and Mark, we can be confused. And many 21st century Westerners do just that. They get confused because they assume Matthew and Mark are chronological. So the other gospel writers were not interested in chronological history, but rather in significance. They wanted to answer the question why, rather than the question when. Now Luke is very interested in historical sequence, so he takes great pains to arrange his account that way. He wants to answer that question, when and in what order did these things occur? And that's the advantage and contribution of Luke has to make. He fits the Western mindset well. So if you're a Westerner reading the Bible, the New Testament for the first time, the Pre-Tathasha, it'd be probably good for you to start in Luke. So when we come to parallel accounts in the order of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John vary, Luke is the one to follow. He alone claims to put his material in historical sequence, and that's what we'll be doing. The others make no such claim. So the need met, the Greeks sought an ideal mind, and they were ideal man, and they were historically minded. Now, concerns. Luke has three main concerns. Luke has a special concern for the city of Jerusalem, and as we go through this gospel, he'll say things about Jerusalem that others will not mention. Luke is concerned about Gentiles and the impact of the good news upon them, and Luke is concerned about women and the impact of good news upon them. All right, at this point, we need to tackle the book of John. This is chart number 1, page 3 in the right-hand column. All right, the theme of the book of John. John's theme is Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God, the divine Son of God. So John emphasizes the deity of Jesus. His audience is all men. John is writing much later than the other gospel writers. He's writing around 90 AD. This gospel was composed, it was written, when the church was made up of second and third generation Christians. These were people who needed more detailed instruction about Yeshua. They needed new defenses for the problem raised by apostasy within the church and by growing opposition from without. Doctrinal variations had begun to appear at this time. Basic Christian truths were being challenged. Therefore, the Gospel of John was written to a rapidly enlarging Gentile audience. However, the book is not necessarily less Jewish. It's as Jewish a gospel account as all the others, and you'll soon be seeing this factor. Now, John wrote this gospel to meet the spiritual need of people that had little background in the Hebrew Scriptures. And John's intention is stated with perfect clarity in John 20, verse 31. But these have been written so that you may believe that Yeshua is the Mashiach, is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. So this is the evangelistic gospel. That's one of John's purposes here. These people needed to understand that Jesus was the Jewish Messiah. They needed to understand that he was God come in the flesh, the God-man, prophesied in the Hebrew Scriptures. And finally, they needed to know that he was the only and exclusive source of spiritual life. Now, concern. In order to communicate all of what we've just stated, John emphasizes what Jesus said rather than what he did. John wants to share exactly what Jesus taught about himself. His primary concern is to add those important things the other three gospel writers did not include. So he's the supplemental gospel as well. He's the evangelistic gospel, and he's the supplemental gospel. By the time John wrote his account, the other three Gospels already had wide circulation. So it was relatively easy to find out what Jesus did. So as a result, John is far more interested in what Jesus said than what Jesus did. So his Gospel has more discourses than any other of the Gospels. It also contains two sub-themes. Write these sub-themes in at the bottom of page 3. I didn't write them in on the outline for you, so at the bottom of page 3, just write these in. The first sub-theme is the conflict between light and darkness. This sub-theme will be pointed out, but it won't be developed as we go through this study. The second sub-theme is Jesus came to reveal the Father. One more thing about John that he likes is that he likes to work around the number 7. So turn to page 4, which is, Jesus came to reveal the Father. Sorry, I forgot to put that up. Okay, that's the two sub-themes. Now, John likes to work around the number 7. So turn to page 4 and John's theme of 7. So in his gospel, we find 7 signs, turning the water into wine, healing the nobleman's son, healing the impotent man, feeding the 5,000, walking on the water, and healing the blind man, and the raising of Lazarus. So we find 7 signs. We then also find 7 discourses, the discourse of the new birth, the works of God, the bread of life, the water of life, the light of the world, the good shepherd, the upper room discourses. So we have 7 signs, 7 discourses, and 7 I am statements. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. So, 7 discourses, 7 I am statements, and 7 discourses, 7 signs, and 7 I am statements. Ooh, I only did 4 there. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way and the truth and the life. I am the true vine. Now, all these will be pointed out as we proceed. 7 signs, 7 discourses, 7 I am statements. Now, 7 in Jewish thinking is associated with sacredness. So here we encounter 7 sacred signs, 7 sacred discourses, 7 sacred I am statements. Now, the number 7 is also associated with completeness. It's associated with sacredness and completeness. For example, creation's completeness. Now, the number 3. The number 3 is associated with completeness, having a beginning, a middle, and an end. So John is telling us that he's communicating through 7 signs, 7 discourses, and 7 I am statements, through 3 groups of 7. He's telling us that he's communicating through 3 groups of 7 a completely adequate sacred account about the coming of the Messiah. Now, 3 is also associated with God. Why? Because God is triune. Now, I know a lot of people have difficulty with this idea of the triunity of God or the Trinity. I know people struggle with this. And I struggled with it for a while until I suddenly dawned on my feeble brain an analogy that cleared it up for me. Now, I don't know if this simple analogy will clear it all up for you, but it cleared it up for me. So let me share this analogy with you. Okay, remember, the book of John is a completely adequate, sacred account of Messiah's life made up of 3 sets of 7. All right, now here's the simple analogy. The simple analogy is the number 333. 333, there it is, okay? Is this 333? No. That's the number 3. Is this 333? No. It's the number 33. Is this 333? No. It's the number 33 again. Is this 333? No, that's just a couple of 3s. Is this 333? No, that's just the number 3 again. Is this 333? No. 333 is made up of 3 distinguishable and co-equal digits that are completely united to form 1 number. 333 does not exist if one of the digits is missing. Each digit is co-equal and essential to the number. In like manner, God is composed of three distinguishable and co-equal persons who are completely united to form one God. God does not exist if one of the persons is missing. Each person is co-equal and essential to the Godhead. Please note well, I am not saying that the Bible teaches that there are three gods. Not saying that at all. The Bible teaches clearly that there is one God and only one God. The one God consists of three distinguishable and co-equal persons inextricably unified. Okay? So I think the number 333 illustrates the triune nature of God very adequately. All right, page five. Let's go back to our automobile account, our automobile accident. And if we were witnessing this automobile accident, what would we see? Well, if you were with the police department, you would interview the eyewitnesses for your accident report. And by comparing the four accounts, you would get a full, well-rounded accident report. From his perspective, Matthew would report on why the dark car was there or the purple car was there and its importance. From his perspective, Mark would report why the light car, the yellow car, was there and its importance. From his perspective, Luke would tell us the chronology of events. Well, the yellow car started into the intersection without stopping, and the purple car couldn't stop in time, and wham, hit him. First this happened, then that happened, then that happened. Chronology. And finally, from his vantage point, John would explain the conversations that occurred. The guy in the blue car came out swearing a blue streak, and the guy in the yellow car came out and responded. And then he said, and then he said, and then he said, and then he said. Different perspectives. Now, in biblical thinking, a matter is established through two or three witnesses. Deuteronomy 19:15. A single witness shall not rise up against a man on account of any iniquity or any sin which he has committed. You know, whether it be major or minor, on the evidence of two or three witnesses, a matter shall be confirmed. Now here we have four witnesses. Four witnesses, and this is not witnessing a traffic accident, but it's witnessing the Messiahship of Yeshua. Four witnesses to the Messiahship of Yeshua. Matthew, he states that Yeshua is King Messiah. Mark, his view is that Yeshua is the servant of the Lord. Luke, Yeshua is the ideal Son of Man. And John, Yeshua is the divine Son of God. He's the royal Messiah, the suffering Messiah. He's the human Messiah. He is the divine Messiah. This is the way to handle so-called contradictory passages. The way to handle them is not to hold them in opposition, but to harmonize the data into a complete and fuller account. Harmonize the data. And let me share with you this letter that came out of Biblical Archaeology Review in 2008, I believe that says. It was entitled Copping Out of My Subscription. It was written by a cop. It was written by a policeman. He starts out, "As a police officer, I have taken eyewitness reports from several people regarding the same incident. Each person sees it a bit differently, and the reports reflect such differences. Do these differences nullify what they saw or discount what happened? No, they don't. Taking each eyewitness statement into account gives a more accurate, clearer picture of what actually transpired." Would this not be true regarding the eyewitnesses of the Bible? Walt Walra, Kalamazoo, Michigan. Thank you, Officer Walt. I rejoiced when I read his letter because he confirmed from a policeman's point of view exactly what I had been talking about as far as the different eyewitnesses' accounts. Okay. Well, I'm out of time here, and it's about time to enter into a discussion of the text itself. So we will pick this lesson up, we'll pick this class up next session, and we'll start in with John chapter 1, verse 1, as we look into the actual text of the Jewish life of Messiah. Thanks so much for being our students. I trust this study will be a great blessing to you. We'll see you next session. Lehitraot. Lehitraot.